بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين الحمد لله with the help and the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This year has commenced, as we all know and we learn, that our calendar, meaning the lunar calendar, is based on the hijrah of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this hijrah that was carried out by the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the sake of deen is such an important advent in our history, in our deen, that our entire calendar is based on this. That every time the year elapses and then commences again, we are reminded of the sacrifices of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Hijrah means to leave one land for another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The lands of kufr and defiance and disbelief, to leave those lands to lands of iman and deen for the pleasure of Allah. And to leave lands where one's iman is being negatively affected, to lands where one would be able to protect his iman. That also is hijrah. And to leave one land for another, to uplift deen there, that also is very, very rewarding. And there also one will be rewarded for hijrah. The hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sahaba is a special hijrah, the most noble of all hijrah. That was specific to Sahaba radiallahu anhum. That was when they left Makkah Mukarramah, the holiest of lands, to Medina Munawwara, also to blessed lands, Medina Munawwara. These are lands loved by Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Medina Munawwara. But Makkah Mukarramah was initially the favorite of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That Allah put the love of Medina Munawwara in the heart of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And from that hijrah we also learn that yes, irrespective of the fact that Makkah was the noblest of all lands, the loftiest of lands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but because practicing deen became impossible there, where the people of Makkah did not appreciate the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam amongst them, they did not welcome the deen of Allah ta'ala wholeheartedly, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told to leave Makkah Mukarramah. Leave Makkah Mukarramah to go to another land. So ungratefulness is such a calamity, such a curse, that actually deprives us of the bounties of Allah, of the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When one is ungrateful to the favors of Allah, one becomes deprived of the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why one amazing dua Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to make, Allahumma ja'alna shakirina li ni'matik, qabiliha, musneena biha, wa atimmaha alayna. O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make us of those who appreciate thy favors. Make us of those who are worthy of your favors, Allah. Musneena biha, make us of those who will praise you abundantly for your favors. Wa atimmaha alayna. And O Allah, continuously shower us with your bounties and favors. Another amazing dua Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught, Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min zawali ni'matik. O Allah, we seek thy protection from your bounties being snatched away from us. O Allah, save us from those deeds that cause your bounties to be snatched away from us. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min zawali ni'matik wa tahawwuli 'afiyatik. O Allah, save us from your wonderful favor that you have given us of afiyah and well-being and comfort and blessings and the ability to practice your deen easily. O Allah, save us from a condition where that bounty of practicing your deen is taken away from us. وَتَحَوُّلِ عَافِيَتِكْ وَجَمِيعِ سَخَطِكْ. Save us from ever angering you in any way. Save us from displeasing you in any way. وَفُجَاءَةِ نِقْمَتِكْ. And O Allah, save us from those actions that cause your punishment to befall us all of a sudden and whilst we unawares. So this ni'mah of the presence of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Makkah Mukarramah was taken away from them momentarily. That's why the statement was heard from the unseen, as Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was on the hijra. What was the statement? In poetry it rendered, فَيَا لَقُصَيِّن مَا زَوَى اللَّهُ عَنْكُمُ بِهِ مِنْ فِعَالٍ لَا تُجَازَ وَسُؤْدُدِي. Oh people of Makkah, what have you done? What have you done that has deprived you of the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being with you, being amongst you? So Allah Ta'ala save us from ungratefulness. Allah save us from ingratitude. So this meaning of hijrah, where Sahaba radiallahu anhum left Makkah Mukarramah to Medina Munawwarah, that special hijrah ended on the occasion of Fath Makkah. But the other meanings of hijrah that we discussed still remains. Like one hijrah is also referred to in the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And every one of us must practice this hijrah. Al-muhajiru man hajara ma naha Allahu anhu. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a muhajir is also he who leaves those things that displease Allah. Allah Ta'ala save us from involving in actions and places and company and things that displease our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Maulana Abu al-Hasan Ali Nadwi rahimahullah explained so beautifully under a topic, Darsum min al-Hijra, wherein he says, one important lesson in Hijra is, this lesson of Hijra, he mentions, وَقَدْ أَثْبَتَتِ الْهِجْرَةُ النَّبَوِيَّةِ. The Hijra of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam proves that أَنَّ الدَّعْوَةَ وَالْعَقِيدَةَ, that da'wat and iman are so important. Da'wat, inviting to Allah, and protecting one's iman. These are such important blessings that yutanazalu lahuma an kulli habibin wa azizin wa alifin wa anis. These two are such great gifts of Allah that everything of value, everything that we are close to, that we are accustomed to, that we are comforted by, that we love and value, should all be sacrificed for da'wat and for iman. But da'wat and iman cannot be sacrificed for anything. We cannot forego da'wat and iman. But we should forego and sacrifice everything for iman and da'wat. What this means is that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would not forsake iman and da'wat, but he could leave Makkah Mukarramah. And yes, he did later on return to Makkah Mukarramah. But this is this very, very important lesson on the importance of iman and the importance of da'wat. So today we're discussing this great sahabi, who was a young sahabi in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he was a specialist in the hadith of Al-Hijra. We're not discussing Suraqa bin Malik radiallahu anhu. We have learnt about his life. We're not discussing Burayda bin Husayb radiallahu anhu. We have studied his life. We're not discussing Amir bin Fuhira radiallahu anhu, who was also with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on this journey. We've studied his life. This sahabi is none other than Al-Barra ibn Azib radiallahu anhu. You would all remember the brother of Anas radiallahu anhu, that is Al-Baraa bin Malik. Just here the difference in pronunciation, Ibn al-Athir rahimahullah clarifies the difference. Even though the words are spelt almost the same, but that sahabi Anas radiallahu anhu's brother is Al-Baraa bin Malik radiallahu anhu. This sahabi is Al-Barra bin Azib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He is one of the specialists in narrating many ahadith, and in our topic, more importantly, the journey of the hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is also one of the aspects he specializes in. Al-Bara means, and Al-Barra, the emphatic phrase of the same, is one who completely and entirely frees oneself from defiance, disobedience, and ascribing partners unto Allah. And he completely turns himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wholeheartedly. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ وَقَوْمِهِ إِنَّنِي بَرَاءٌ مِّمَّا تَعْبُدُونَ. Allah ta'ala mentions Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, where he said to his people, I am free from what you are attributing unto Allah. And that which you worship,
I free myself from that. I turn to Allah completely. And the word would also mean to sharpen and to be very sharp. So someone who's wise and sharp and intelligent. Allah give us tawfiq and accept us all and our children and our offspring to be like the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. The Sahabi's father, Aazib, he was also a Sahabi of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Nawawi rahimahullah says, his mother's name was Habiba binti Abi Habiba radiallahu anha. And his father was Aazib radiallahu anhu, both were great Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Zahabi rahimahullah says, his father was one of the senior Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Both embraced Islam together. And they spent time with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the initial stages after the hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Baraa or Al-Barraa radiallahu anhu, actually both pronunciations are correct, but Ibn al-Athir rahimahullah prefers Al-Barraa. Anyway, this great Sahabi Al-Barraa radiallahu anhu, with lot of precision, narrates so many ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam right from the hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Barraa radiallahu anhu's mama, meaning his mother's brother, was also a great Sahabi, famous Sahabi, Abu Burda ibn Niyar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Al-Barraa radiallahu anhu also narrates the ahadith, these many ahadith. Amongst them was this one wherein he said, after the hijrah, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed Sahaba to perform the hijrah, the first amongst them to come to us was Mus'ab ibn Umair وابن أم مكتوم رضي الله عنهما. These two great Sahaba came before everyone else and they would sit with us and teach us Quran. So Al-Barraa رضي الله عنه from his tender age would learn Quran from these two senior Sahaba Muhajirin, Mus'ab ibn Umair and Abdullah bin Umm Maktoum رضي الله عنهم. And then he says, then Ammar radiallahu anhu, Bilal radiallahu anhu, Sa'ad bin Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu migrated. He says, after that, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu migrated with 20 others. Because many joined in with Umar radiallahu anhu as he was traveling along his journey. As we all would remember, previously we discussed Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu, who was with Umar radiallahu anhu on the journey. And then Hisham radiallahu anhu didn't make it. But many others joined Umar radiallahu anhu en route because they loved to be in the company and the protection and the guidance of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Then Al-Barraa radiallahu anhu says, then when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrived in Medina Munawwara, what an arrival, what an appearance it was. I never saw the people of Medina so joyous, so happy, like they were on the occasion of the arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, by the time Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrived in Medina Munawwara, I had memorized most of the surahs from the Mufassal, meaning from Hujurat right till Suratul Nas. So many of those surahs, including Sabbih Isma Rabbika Al-A'la, I had memorized already from the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. This is how the Sahaba would love to learn from their seniors and respect them, and they would take every opportunity to learn and improve and enhance their knowledge. See how they would enhance their knowledge. Musnad Ahmad narrates from Al-Barraa bin Aazib radiallahu anhu. He says, Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu purchased from my father a saddle for 13 dirhams. So Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu requested Hazrat Aazib radiallahu anhu, would you please instruct your son Al-Barraa to deliver my goods to my home, please? He said, I would not do so until you teach us this hadith. Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu asked, which hadith it was? Is it that you're referring to? حَتَّى تُحَدِّثَنَا كَيْفَ صَنَعْتَ حِينَ خَرَجَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَأَنْتَ مَعَهُ. Narrate to us the entire detailed incident when yourself and Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم undertook the journey of hijrah. Immediately Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه started narrating. Subhanallah. Sahaba loved and took every opportunity to learn. And Sahaba radiallahu anhum seized every opportunity to disseminate and impart. He says, خَرَجْنَا فَأَدْلَجْنَا فَأَحْتَثْنَا يَوْمَنَا وَلَيْلَتَنَا. Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu narrated the entire incident. How we left early, how we hastened our pace, how we concealed ourselves in the cave, how we traveled. And then one specific incident he mentions here as well. One incident Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu mentions, he says, on one occasion we were traveling and it was very, very hot. And then it was the time of chasht. فَضَرَبْتُ basadi. I searched and I found some shade because of a rock. And from there, in that shade, I prepared bedding for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I prepared this bedding and then I put the skin, this dry skin, farwa. And then I requested, O Nabi of Allah, would you lie down? And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rested for a while. And I went in the different directions, looking and scouting if there's any danger around. I then found a shepherd. And I said to him, who do you belong to? He mentioned. And then I knew that individual. I asked him then, would you be able to arrange some milk for us? He said, sure. And I asked him to milk for me. And then I said to him, please milk for us. I guided him on how to milk. I made sure the dust was removed. I then milked for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this container, this leather skin. And when I milked it for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I, with some procedure, made it cool. I then came to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When I arrived in his company, he had just awakened sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I requested him, O Nabi of Allah, please drink. He drank and I insisted that he drink more. He made me happy and drank. فَشَرِبَ حَتَّى رَضِيتْ. And then I said, O Nabi of Allah, is it now time to depart? And we then continued our journey. And they were laying a heavy chase on us. وَالْقَوْمُ يَتْلُبُونَنَا. And amongst the few that caught up with us was Suraqa bin Malik, who then on his fast horse was chasing us. And in that, I said, O Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the scouts and the searchers and the hunters have found us. Allah's Nabi said to me, O Abu Bakr, la tahzan, don't grieve for me, Abu Bakr. Inna Allah ma'ana, certainly Allah is with us. Allah is with us. When he came so close, Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, I then started to cry. Allah's Nabi reassured me, why do you cry, O Abu Bakr? I said, O Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I am crying in worry for you. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not worry, Abu Bakr. He asked Allah, Allahumma kfinahu bima shi'at. O Allah, you protect us from him in a manner that you deem it fit. And Allah made it that the hooves of his horse sunk into the ground right through the belly of the horse. Fi ardin saldin. Allah made it that the hooves sunk into hard ground. He tried to actually spur on his horse and get out of the ground. And he couldn't. And then Suraqa said, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I know you're the cause of this. Pray to Allah to save me from my condition. And by Allah, I would protect you from the coming people. And then that incident is lengthy, which we have discussed. But this entire report is that of Hazrat al-Baraa bin Aazib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. One of the specialities of this sahabi, al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu, is he describes Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's beautiful appearance, countenance and character. Other sahaba who specialized in this, we've studied before, Ummu Ma'bad radiyallahu anha, who describes Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in such an amazing manner. And we also have, which we discussed before, Hind ibn Abi Hala radiyallahu anhu, Khadija radiyallahu anha's son, who grew up under the care of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who professionally described Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in such an amazing manner, which we have discussed with the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the ahadith wherein al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu describes Habibullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rajulan marbu'a. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was perfect in every way. And his every part of him was perfectly moderate. Allah made him perfect so that everyone can strive and follow him. Bu'aydu ma bayn al-mankibayn. His shoulders were broad and solid. His hair was long till his earlobe. On this occasion, he says, I saw him with a kurta with some red stripes on it. Allah's Nabi was so beautiful. Ma ra'aytu shay'an qattu ahsana minhu. I have not seen in my entire life anyone more beautiful than he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is one hadith he describes Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But there's so many which we have discussed before. Among the other hadith, Hazrat al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu narrates is the etiquettes of sleeping. He says Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would go to bed, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would place his right palm under his right cheek. وَضَعَ كَفَّهُ الْيُمْنَى تَحْتَ خَدِّهِ الْأَيْمَنِ. And Allah's Nabi would say, رَبِّ قِنِي عَذَابَكَ يَوْمَ تَبْعَثُ عِبَادَكَ. Oh my Rabb, save me from your punishment the day you resurrect your bando, your servants. In one hadith he narrates, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would retire to his bedding, he would say, Allahumma ilayka aslamtu nafsi. O Allah, I surrender my soul unto you. Allahumma aslamtu nafsi ilayk. O Allah, I hand over my nafs to you. I surrender my soul to you. Wawajjahtu wajhi ilayk. O Allah, I totally direct my attention to you. وَفَوَّضْتُ أَمْرِي إِلَيْكَ. O Allah, I rely on you totally. I completely hand over my affairs to you, my Allah. وَأَلْجَأْتُ ظَهْرِي إِلَيْكَ. O Allah, I make you my resort and my protector for anything that comes to attack me from my rear and my back. O Allah, I turn to you in every condition. رَغْبَةً وَرَهْبَةً إِلَيْكَ. In conditions of ease and adversity, in conditions where I am excited and active, and in conditions where I suffer difficulty and problems. La malja wa la manja mink illa ilayk. O Allah, there's no place of resort, there's no place of salvation except to you, my Allah. I bring firm iman in the book that you revealed and in your Nabi that you sent. آمَنْتُ بِكِتَابِكَ الَّذِي أَنزَلْتُ وَبِنَبِيِّكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتُ. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, one who reads this and then passes away will leave this world with complete iman. What an amazing dua. We all worry what would happen at night, what attacks may happen. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, place one's reliance completely in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is taught to us via this sahabi, al-Baraa radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And there's so many du'as he taught the ummah. The famous du'a we read when we awaken, Hazrat al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu says that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would awaken, he would say, alhamdulillah, all praises to Allah. Alladhi ahyana, Allah is that one who gave us life, min ba'di ma amatana, after death. وَإِلَيْهِ النُّشُورِ. And to Allah alone is our resurrection. To Allah alone we will gather one day. And to Allah, before Allah alone we would stand. And he also narrates the hadith wherein Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught when going to sleep. اللهم بسمك أحيا وبسمك أموت. O Allah, in your name I live and in your name I die. These are beautiful du'as that we should learn, that has reached us via this great sahabi, al-Baraa ibn Aazib, radiyallahu anhu. Very interesting also is the way Hazrat al-Baraa, radiyallahu anhu, would explain the Qur'an al-Kareem. Just a few ayat he would explain. In Surah al-Baqarah, the initial verses of the second juz of the Qur'an, after أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم سيقول السفهاء من الناس ما ولاهم عن قبلتهم التي كانوا عليها قل لله المشرق والمغرب يهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم. The translation of the verse is wherein the fools would say that what has turned them away from the qibla that they were upon. Al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu explains that the verses of the Qur'an refer to the Jews as fools here. Because what had happened was, when Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrived in Medina Munawwara, they would face Baytul Muqaddas. And this continued for approximately 16 to 17 months. If we could remember the Sahabi Talha bin Baraa radiallahu anhu, who wanted to face Kaaba Sharif before the Hijra stage. And when he came to meet Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam during the Hajj, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah has instructed Baytul Muqaddas, remain on that Qibla. So Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu says, Sahaba continued facing Baytul Muqaddas for 17 months. And their hearts were yearning to face Kaaba. So the Jews then said, what is wrong with them? What has taken them away from the Qibla that they were upon? Meaning now, why is Quran telling them to face Kaaba when for 16 months they were facing Baytul Muqaddas? Ulama write the wisdom behind this is that when they came to Medina Munawwara and the people, the Jewish people were actually, they would pray towards Baytul Muqaddas. This would have been a means to win them over to Islam, proving to them that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is on the practice of all the Anbiya alayhi musallatu wasallam. But because of the stubbornness and the hard-heartedness of the Jews and their defiance, most of them didn't accept. But they were those who were pure and became great Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. And as the verses continue, Al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu explains the next verse, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ, wherein Allah Ta'ala says, Allah would not forsake your iman. Allah would not let your iman go to waste. Because what had happened here was, this is a continuation of the previous verses, that Sahaba radiyallahu anhum were facing Baytul Muqaddas. And after 17 months, they were then told to face Kaaba Sharif. قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ. Allah Ta'ala says, certainly we see how you would look at the sky awaiting Allah's command to channel you to Kaaba Sharif. Now face the Kaaba Sharif. And in that, there were those who said, those who passed away in the initial stage in Medina Munawwara, who were still facing Baytul Muqaddas, what would be their condition? Allah says, Allah would never forsake your iman. Allah will never let your iman go to waste. Al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu explains, iman here refers to salah, subhanallah. We learn from this explanation that how important is salah, that Quran refers to salah with the wordings of iman. That salah is iman and iman is salah. How important is our salah, that it is a great part of iman. Allah is saying that those who were facing Baytul Muqaddas and they left this world, Allah still accepts the iman and Allah is still accepting their prayer. How intricate and beautiful is the explanations of Al-Baraa radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Likewise, Al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu would very often teach the ummah the practices of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, especially salah. His son Yazid ibn Al-Baraa ibn Aazib radiyallahu anhu says that my father would gather us, his students and his children, and he would actually teach us. He would gather his entire family and he would say, اجتمعوا فلأريكم كيف كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتوضا وكيف كان يصلي. He says, gather, come sit by me. I want to teach you how Allah's Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم would perform wudu, how Allah's Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم would perform salah. And then he would gather them. And he would say, learn as much as you can from me. I don't know how long I would remain amongst you. He would teach them the entire proper sunnat wudu of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in detail, limb for limb, with the masah, the full masah on the head and washing the feet and performing the entire wudu. And then he would say, this is the best I tried to do to explain to you Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's wudu. Then he would enter his home and perform his sunnah salahs. And then he would come out and then the adhan, the iqama would take place. And he would lead us in the dhuhr prayer. And he was obviously reciting softly, but me standing right behind him, I would hear a few verses. He would be reciting Surah Yasin. And then he would perform asr salah. And after that, at the time of Maghrib, he would lead us in Maghrib Salah. And then he would lead us in Isha Salah from the masjid. And then he would teach us and then say to us that this is how Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would perform his wudu and present and perform his salah. This is how Al-Baraa radiyallahu anhu and all the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum would passionately teach their students and teach their children. Respected lovers of Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, whatever little we know of the deen of Allah, impart it, share it. Deen is shared from heart to heart, lovingly, kindly, sweetly. When we share the deen of Allah, whatever we know, we would teach the next. When we leave this world, that chain would continue, and that is our investment in akhirah. That is the greatest investment. And this is of those deeds that do not stop and that don't terminate when we share any aspect of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But let's make sure what we teaching of the deen of Allah is not an innovation, is not something contrary to the deen of Allah. That's why I always verify with the ulama. Once we verify, let's impart what we know. Allah give us tawfiq.
Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu also on many occasions strove in the path of Allah ta'ala from his tender age, being very close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I even tried to participate in Badr, but Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent me back with others. Then I managed to join in Uhud and in Khandaq. He was a contemporary of Hazrat Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhu. Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu says, Kuntu ana wa ibn Umar lida. Myself and Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhuma were contemporaries. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah mentions in his Isaba that Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu said, Hazrat Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu said, غزوت مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم 15 غزوة. I went on 15 occasions in expedition with Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I travelled with him on 18 safars and journeys, learning so much from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu says, I saw Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the day of Khandaq. I saw him digging and removing the sand, and his entire chest was filled with dust. And I heard him rendering the words of Abdullah bin Rawaha radiallahu anhu. What were the words of Hazrat Abdullah bin Rawaha radiallahu anhu? Wherein he would say, Allahumma lawla anta mahtadayna wala tasaddaqna wala sallayna faanzilan sakinatan alayna wa thabbitil aqdama illa qayna innal ula qad baghu alayna idha aradu fitnatan abayna. Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu says, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say these words, Oh Allah, lawla anta mahtadayna. If it's not for you, we would not be on hidayat. Oh Allah, we are on hidayat through your blessings and your bounties and your kindness and your favor. Oh Allah, if it wasn't for you, we would not be able to sacrifice for your deen. Oh Allah, if it's not for you, if it's not for your favor and tawfiq, we would not even be able to perform salah. So oh Allah, everything happens through your tawfiq. Oh Allah, shower us anzilan, your mercies and your tranquility upon us. And oh Allah, when we face challenges, keep our feet firm on iman and on your order. Oh Allah, those are the ones who transgressed upon us. But oh Allah, when they want to trial us, and when they want to take us away from you, and your order, and your deen, we would never accept it. Abayna, abayna, abayna. Oh Allah, certainly we would refuse when anyone tries to make us forsake our deen, and iman, and a'mal. Oh Allah, we would never ever forsake your command, your deen. Subhanallah. These words Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were repeating as he was helping the Sahaba in serving and participating himself in the digging of the trench. Subhanallah. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself was putting his hand in the qurbani and in the sacrifice. Allah give us tawfiq. Allah aliven for us the fikr of ijtimaz, where this also gives us that opportunity to be able to, in a small way, bring alive these beautiful sunan of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another beautiful incident narrated by Al-Baraa bin Aazib radiallahu anhu, as documented by and reported by Imam Muslim rahimahullah, that a man comes to Hazrat Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu and said, أَكُنْتُمْ وَلَّيْتُمْ يَوْمَ حُنَيْنٍ يَا أَبَا عُمَارَةٍ. Did you all flee from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Did you all forsake him on the occasion of Hunayn? Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu said, I bear witness Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not turn his back. But yes, it was those of us who turned. What had happened was the nations of Hawazin, who were masters in archery, waited in ambush, and as we arrived, they shot us from all directions, كَأَنَّمَا رِجْلٌ مِّنْ جَرَادٍ, and they attacked like swarms of locusts. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continued with Abu Sufyan bin Harith radiallahu anhu, And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then said, أَنَا النَّبِيُّ لَا كَذِبْ أَنَا بْنُ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبْ أَنَا النَّبِيُّ لَا كَذِبْ أَنَا بْنُ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبْ اللَّهُمَّ نَزِّلْ نَصْرَكْ. I am the Nabi of Allah. There's no lie in this. I remind you that I am the son of Abdul Muttalib. I am the offspring of Abdul Muttalib. Al-Baraa radiallahu anhu says, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so brave. Whenever conditions would intensify, we all would take protection in him, the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's an amazing discussion here. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in these words, as he was darting towards the Hawazin people who were attacking the Sahaba and shooting them from all directions like swarms of locusts, he said, I am the Nabi of Allah, without doubt, I am the offspring of Abdul Muttalib. What he said is, Anabnu, I am the son of Abdul Muttalib. When we study historically, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's father's name was Abdullah, who was the son of Abdul Muttalib. The question comes about, why did he affiliate himself to his grandfather? One response is, his father passed away very young, and his grandfather was known, and his grandfather nurtured him and grew him. The other response is, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reminding them of Abdul Muttalib's words to all the Arabian people. Abdul Muttalib told them, because Abdul Muttalib had seen the dream wherein he was given glad tidings of the arrival of the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then just to back this report, there's an amazing report by Al-Bayhaqi rahimahullah in his Dala'il al-Nubuwa, a lengthy report that goes similar to this, that when Saif ibn Dhi Yazan became the ruler of Yemen, the seniors of Makkah traveled to Yemen to congratulate him, namely Abdul Muttalib bin Hashim, Umayyah bin Abd Shams, Abdullah bin Judan, Asad bin Abdul Uzza, Wahab bin Abd Manaf, Qusay bin Abd Dar, and they all came to congratulate him. As Saif sat with glory, and he was anointed with his perfumes and swords all around him, with big dignitaries sitting all around his side. And then when Abdul Muttalib's delegation arrived, they were given permission to enter. Abdul Muttalib then sought permission to speak. Saif said to him, if you are worthy to speak before the rulers, we then give you permission. And he rendered such amazing words in the court of this ruler, Saif ibn Dhi Yazan, wherein he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ أَحَلَّكَ أَيُّهَا الْمَلِكَ مَحَلًّا رَفِيعًا شَامِخًا بَادِخًا مَنِيعًا وَأَنْبَتَكَ نَبَاتًا طَابَتْ أُرُومَتُهُ وَعَظُمَتْ جُرْثُومَتُهُ وَثَبَتَ أَصْلُهُ وَسَبَقَ فَرْعُهُ فِي أَطْيَبِ مَوْضِعٍ وَأَكْرَمِ مَعْدٍ وَأَنْتَ أَبَيْتَ اللَّعَنْ مَلِكَ الْعَرَبِ الَّذِي لَهُ تَنْقَادُ وَعَمُودَهَا الَّذِي عَلَيْهِ الْعِمَادُ وَمَعْقِلَهَا الَّذِي يَلْجَأُ إِلَيْهِ الْعِبَادُ. And he spoke so eloquently. And then he said, we come from the haram. We are the caretakers and the servants of the Kaaba. We have come to congratulate you. His words were so eloquent that Saif then says to him, who are you, O the one who speaks to me? He says, I am Abdul Muttalib bin Hashim. He says, oh, you are the son of our sister. Bring him closer, bring him closer. To remind us, my respected lovers of Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, Abdul Muttalib's father Hashim married Salma from Medina Munawwara, from the tribes of Medina Munawwara, one of the senior tribes there. That's what Saif the Yazan means, because the people of Medina Munawwara were originally from Yemen. He then said, Marhaban wa ahlan, welcome, welcome, my arms are open to you, my home is your home. And here is your family. He was the first of the Arabs to say these words. It then became very famous. And then they were taken to a place to rest. And after some time, he called for Abdul Muttalib. And he spoke to him privately, explaining to him what he knew of the arrival of the final Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He described Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every aspect about him. The fact that his father would leave this world before him. Not long after that, his mother, his grandfather would nurture him and care for him. And then Saif the Yazan is explaining to Abdul Muttalib, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's
attributes and qualities and generosity and his worship to one Allah, and how he would defeat shaitan and destroy every force of batil. قوله فصل, his word would be wise and decisive. وحكمه عدل, his decisions would be just. وَيَأْمُرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَفْعَلُ, he advocates good and he himself practices it, and he negates and forbids evil and he himself abstains from it. Towards the end of the discussion, Sayyid the Yazan explains to Abdul Muttalib, this is your grandson. Abdul Muttalib falls into sajda and thanks Allah for this. The incident is lengthy, wherein at the end, as Saif ibn the Yazan makes ikram and honors the entire delegation with so much of wealth and gifts, he grants Abdul Muttalib 10 times more than everyone else. And as they return, Abdul Muttalib says to them that if you all are envious of me for what the king did for me, all these things, what he gave me, definitely perishes. If you only know what Allah has in store for me, then certainly you would actually become more jealous of what I have been blessed with. When they would ask him, what do you mean? He would say, after some time, certainly you would have to come to know. If even said to Abdul Muttalib that after the year passes, come and give me information about young Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but Allah's will, save during the interim of that year, left this world. Anyway, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam on this occasion of Hunain was reminding all the people there, Ana ibn Abdul Muttalib, don't you remember what Abdul Muttalib informed you and notified you about the arrival of the final Nabi of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Here I am Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This hadith of Hunain, Hazrat al-Barra radiallahu anhu narrates, he spent his entire life serving deen like all the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Let us all play our part. We will continue the discussion with the fadl and the karam and the tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil ummi.